Hello and welcome to the St. Andrews Society of Los Angeles podcast. Each episode will bring you the latest news from the St. Andrews Society of Los Angeles, as well as fascinating interviews with entertainment personalities, government leaders, and community advocates. St. Andrews Society of Los Angeles, where Scotland meets the City of Angels. Let's get started. Our guest interviewer today is Bethany Rayburn. Bethany is a St. Andrews Society member and is an art educator with an affinity for dance, theater, and classic film musicals. And our guest today is film historian Patricia Ward Kelly. Patricia is the widow and official biographer of Gene Kelly. She has worked as a writer, freelance journalist, and as a contributing scholar for the authoritative Northwestern Newbery Writings of Herman Melville. Patricia and Gene met at the Smithsonian in 1985, where he was host narrator for a television special and for which she was a writer. Soon after, he invited her to California to write his memoirs, a job in which she recorded his words nearly every day for over 10 years. Currently, she serves as trustee for the Gene Kelly Image Trust, the entity Kelly established during his lifetime to govern the use of his name and likeness. She is also president and creative director of Gene Kelly Legacy, Inc., a corporation established to celebrate Kelly's artistry and to perpetuate his legacy worldwide. She lives in Los Angeles, where she is completing the book about her late husband. Please welcome Patricia Ward Kelly.
I heard that you were interested in becoming the best Melville scholar possible. So how did somebody with degrees in American literature seg to being a research assistant for PBS? And, you know, that little change there, it changed your life. How did that happen for you?
Well, and I was in graduate school and fully intending, I was at the University of Virginia and fully intending to go on as a Melville person, because I had had the great privilege of working with the Melville scholars who were primarily based in Chicago at the time. And I worked in Chicago, the Melville Library is there at the Newbery Library. So I worked there and was working with them. They were recreating the authoritative text for Melville, and it was the Northwestern Newbery Press. And so I came on as a research person, and I think I'm named as a contributing scholar for that. And I would work on the historical notes. And it was really where I always say that I'm the kind of girl who gets really excited about a semicolon, because it's where I learned it was very critical to what I'm doing now, because the first thing that the one professor said to me when I arrived, he said, never trust the printed word. And to this day, it's such an important thing, because I think you pick up a copy of Moby Dick and you think that's Moby Dick. Well, it isn't. And each edition is different. And what you'll see is that over the years, type would break and they wouldn't bother to fix it. And so letters would get dropped off, semicolons would get dropped off.
Wow.
Sometimes an editor would catch on to all of Melville's sexual innuendo and would subtly edit all of that out. And so I thought you pick up Moby Dick, it's Moby Dick, and it isn't. And so it was really important, because they said, you must go back to the primary sources. You must not read the things, but you have to go back. And so what my job was to go back to Melville's primary sources and to see how he took the material and made it his own. And I would then, by looking at his sources, I could often discover errors in the text and things that had been misinterpreted or changed. And so I read all of the old sea captain's journals that he read, all the stories of the Galapagos, it was really fantastic. And I also went to all of the collections. I went to Harvard, I went to UVA to look at Melville's manuscripts. And what I then did was I would compare and I could watch his creative process as he went along and would scratch something out and then put something in. And so I could also see from that where typesetters had made mistakes and editors had changed things. And so it was a phenomenal training, much more than you would get in regular graduate school. And so from there, I was hired by a film company in Washington, D.C., to be a researcher on a film about Herman Melville for PBS. And then I was brought on as a writer of that project. And then subsequently, that same film company ended up doing other projects about Thomas Wolfe and Scott Fitzgerald and Ernest Hemingway and Robert Rauschenberg and Robert Penhoren. I was headed back to graduate school, actually, to complete my PhD. And I thought, it's time to go now. And they had one last project, which was a 90-minute television special about the Smithsonian. And so I said, okay, I'll stay. And I was brought on as a researcher. And then eventually they ended up firing the two writers and brought me on as a writer. And the host narrator was to be Gregory Peck. And I had seen To Kill a Mockingbird, so I didn't know who that was. And then at the last minute, they said this person named Gene Kelly was going to be the host narrator. And I had absolutely no clue who that was. I couldn't tell if it was a man or a woman. And all the people on the set were talking about that thing called Singing in the Rain that was to die for. I had no idea what they were talking about, because it just wasn't my world. I had lived my life in a library and not going to the movies. And I certainly my mother didn't keep me home from school to watch television like many. Now I hear from everybody now, like, oh, my mom would keep me home to watch Singing in the Rain. It's like, not my mom. So it was in this funny circumstance that I got tossed in the room with Gene, because all of the women were at him to get a marriage proposal out of him. So the director said, I'll put her in the room to keep everybody away. And so here I am with this guy. I don't know who he is. And he must have been completely amused by what he saw in front of him, because I had this long, thick brown hair and I was wearing a man's lumber jacket. And I mean, I was no makeup. But it was an amazing thing, because I spent a week with him having no idea of his celebrity. And we bonded over words. We bonded over my pet studies in graduate school were etymology and poetry. And those were Gene's pet studies. So
really,
in this room, quoting poetry back and forth and playing word games. And he had all these limericks and things. And
oh, gosh. Now, do you recall what books and poetry that you and Gene discussed that first week?
Yeah, I mean, I remember certainly even the very first things, because it was obviously one of them was Yeats' poem, The Lake Isle of Innisfree. And Gene didn't think that I would know the opening lines, and I did. And then so the words came out of him. It was a natural thing. He wasn't using Latin phrases or a French phrase or a quote or something to show that he knew it so much. It was because he loved it so much, and he loved the sound of words and absorbed them. And we often just sit in a chair and say them over and over because he loved the way they rolled off of his, you know, he could hear it. And so by the end of the week, I was completely enchanted. And oh, did I mention that he was drop dead gorgeous? you've got this incredible man in front of you who's terribly, terribly handsome, terribly charming, terribly witty, and incredibly bright. And I just, by the end of the week, I was gone, but I still had no idea he was famous. So we exchanged phone numbers, and he ended up calling me about 6 months later. And that's when he asked me to come to California. And I didn't know why I was coming. He just said he had several writing projects. But as it turned out, he asked me to come out and write his memoir with him. And I never I thought it would be maybe a couple weeks or something. I never dreamed that 5 years later we'd get married and I would end up recording him.
Throughout his career at MGM and beyond, Gene cultivated an image of the all-American everyman. He was athletic, a little tough, masculine. The quote that's attributed to him is, if Fred Astaire was the Cary Grant of dance, I was Brando. So
that'll interrupt you because that is not Gene's quote.
So really? Okay. So that is apocryphal.
It is always gets attributed to him, but it was actually a reviewer who said it and not Gene, but it's become, and it isn't something that Gene would say. It's sort of, he would never have said that.
Wow.
So it's on posters and things, but
right.
We get to correct that one here because it was not like Gene to say that about himself. He wouldn't do that. And it was somebody writing about Gene who said it.
Yeah. So, the difference between his public image, again, being the everyman, and this person that you knew who was intellectual, sensitive, romantic, what more can you tell us about him?
Well, I think that's what's very interesting is that people see him up on screen and they say, I get letters from a lot of people and they say, you know, I just feel like I could sit down and have a beer with that guy.
Right.
And everyone feels like if they had just met him, that he would have married them, that if only I hadn't come along, then they would have had that opportunity. And I think that's part of the great thing about Gene is that accessibility or appearance of accessibility. But I think it's also one of the things that is sort of misrepresents him, because what you have, you lose then the many dimensions of the man, you lose the complexity of the man. So mm-hmm. I think what you get the sense of a kind of not so educated, not the cerebral guy, but the guy who just kind of gets up and dances and everything, and not certainly not the true Renaissance man Gene was. So when I do my one woman show about him, people walk out and they say, you know, I loved him before, but I love him even more now. I had no idea. They have no idea that he's this multi-layered, complex, contradictory in many ways human being. And I think that's what makes him interesting, that I think that he's very one-dimensional on the screen, charming, glorious, wonderful, and everything, but when you really get down to the layers and you begin to see that mind working and the languages, the study of history, the study of art, the study of economics, poetry, politics, I mean, then he's got a richness to him, a dynamism that I think is missing from the quote, happy-go-lucky guy on the screen.
Hi.
And also I think what you miss is a sense of a man who really cherished his privacy and cherished aloneness in being away from the public eye, and being just the greatest night for him was to sit at home by the fire and listen to Frank Sinatra and Nat King Cole on the stereo and read a book and drink a vodka tonic and laugh and or watch me decorate the Christmas tree or something, or sit upstairs and read next to one another. That was his idea of a great time. And yet I think people imagine he's out at parties and he's just the life of the party. And that was very much not hit Gene, certainly in the decades that I was with him.
Mm-hmm. Now, if we go back to the golden age of Hollywood and Metro, Gene started there in 1941 at the height of the studio system. He became part of the celebrated Freed Unit, which produced the best of the best musicals at MGM during his time there. For those who are not film buffs, can you tell us a little bit about the Freed Unit and Gene's role there?
The Freed Unit was, as you say, quite exceptional. And I think Jean and Vincent Minnelli were very important in building the, quote, freed unit, because Minnelli and Kelly came out from New York and they brought with them a lot of the great talents. So these people kind of began Walters, and you had the Betty Comden and Adolph Greens and the all these extraordinary people starting to come out to be part of that unit. Mm-hmm. And Freed was open to that, which was great. And there were many other great producers there. You had Joe Pasternak. You had other people doing things like Anchors Away and wonderful stuff and very, very tuned into Gene. But the Freed unit, Freed's group, it what was amazing was that it was this extraordinary repertory company basically under one roof. So you didn't, nowadays, people always say, well, why don't they make musicals now? Well, you can't, because it's too expensive and it's too difficult. But there you had, under one roof, you had the composers, the arrangers, the dancers, the choreographer, the director, the writers, and they could go from one cubicle, they could go cross over and meet, and Gene would be going into the MGM Thalberg building and Irving Berlin would be coming out and they'd stop and talk about the American Paris Ballet. And it was this, you can imagine this very heady atmosphere of creativity. And so Gene could sit down and work with the arrangers like Roger Edens and Saul Chaplin and Connie Salinger, and he could then go to the rehearsal hall and he'd have them on the piano and he could take what was in his head and start to work the arrangement with them and then go and record the music. And so all of this is happening. It's just this dynamic environment of creativity and brightness and very just exciting. I mean, you can imagine what was going on under that roof.
While working in Britain, Gene and Arthur Freed decided to go to Scotland to scout film locations, sort of like what they had done for On the Town. So what can you tell us about Gene's trip to Scotland for Brigadoon and their intentions for the film?
I think in those days it was quite glamorous, and the dining cars and the things, and you would go and sleep and then wake up with the beautiful hillsides of Scotland. And Gene came into the train station in Glasgow, and I have these glorious photographs of him. I mean, he's, again, I just keep coming back to his drop-dead gorgeousness, but he's so great, and he's in his Irish caps, and he's in his overcoat, and he stayed at the Grand Central Hotel there, and then set off and had a map and set off with Arthur Freed, and really fully intending to shoot Brigadoon there, and found all kinds of wonderful locations for it. And I think Gene, as you probably have read, always saw it as kind of a John Ford Western, that you would literally have these clans coming over the hills. And he I think he really felt that the choreography would be amazing for that. And so there's a lot of mythology about it. You hear things that, but Gene did want to do it, and Freed did want to do it. But then by the time they got back to the studio, the studio was cutting back on all the budgets. And they even then looked at Northern California spots and found places that would work. And they couldn't even do that. So they crafted it all on stage. And the sets or the backdrops are quite phenomenal. I mean, they're quite beautiful.
They are.
And I think what's interesting is that what you read in biographies, which I encourage you not to read, there's very little that's accurate in them. But you read that Gene did Sing in the Rain, and then it was this grand spiral downward. And Gene never could understand that, because he said, but I did Brigadoon, and that has two of the best pas de deux that I ever did on film. And I think, as I started, I always thought, well, people, the biographers and film historians put Brigadoon down. They kind of say it's a less than. And I was reluctant to even start posting about it on social media. And then I started posting about it during COVID. And it was really interesting because people love it. And,
yes.
And they connect to it in a way. And I think particularly during this time of lockdown, there was some sense of this kind of magical world that only comes around every 100 years. And this kind of need for some kind of magical story in our lives, and that realism wasn't necessarily all it was cut out to be. And yeah, there's some funny scenes with some of the stuff and the hills and things, but there's great beauty in it. And I was really happy to read that people got that, and the music. I mean, what better Lerner and Lowe and...
Right.
And it wasn't originally a dance picture. I mean, that's the thing, is that it's a singer's work on stage. It's not
right.
Dance. So Gene had to really work to figure out how do you convert this to a vehicle for a dancer and make that the thing. And the beauty of Gene and Sid in Heather on the Hill, I mean, it just takes your breath away. And so I was really glad. I'm glad that people are smarter than the critics, in a way. I think people get stuff.
When you talk about how quickly he learned all of these different dances and how he studied them and just kind of picked them up, my question is, what was his relationship with actual music itself? Because it seems like that would go so hand in hand.
Well, he would give you a big hug right now, because that's the thing. That was the thing, is that Gene knew music and understood music. And that's why he was able to do what he did when everybody in Hollywood said, you can't do this. You cannot dance with yourself in alter ego number in Cover Girl. It's impossible because you can't dolly and pan in double exposure. And he said, I can. And the reason he knew he could was that it was music. It was, he would connect the movement of the camera to the musical beats, and he would time it. So he had to hit his marks, which were counted off in musical beats. And the camera, his assistant stood behind the camera and counted the camera off in musical beats. And then it was in sync. And that's how you could do the animation. You could do what he did that was so revolutionary that nobody understood. And so it was all connected to the music. And so that's a very sophisticated thing, because most people don't grasp that and one of the questions I asked him was, what came first, the music or the dance? What comes first? And he said, generally in classical ballet, the music starts. You take the music and then you put the dance on top of that. You make it fit the music. He said, I started generally with the dance, and then I would work with an arranger to make it work with the music. And so it was the dance that came first, and the story, the narrative of it that propelled it. And then the arranger helped him to make that, to tell that story. And then it all came together, but it's all connected to musical beats. And that's why it's really funny, because people call him a perfectionist and all of this, and it's like, no, he was a professional, and the precision required.
Right.
Extraordinary, because he knew if that camera didn't hit that mark at the right time and he didn't hit his mark, you have to do it again. And it's just a waste of time and money. And the camera operators and the people moving the dollies and things, they didn't have an understanding of music and musical beats. So that's why the assistants would stand behind and count 1, 2, 3, 4, go, and push and stop it. And they actually put a safety pin in the sprocket of the camera, the old Mitchell camera, so that when it rolled around, it would end up and stop at the right spot. So it was this very, very coordinated effort, but yes, it's all in the music. The only time that he said that he ever kind of started with the music was with the ballet. So with American and Paris Ballet, he had this concrete piece that he had to work with. And, but that also required arranging. It was Saul Chaplin who did that. And Saul Chaplin said it was akin to arranging Beethoven. I mean, you come in and it was very kind of, you just don't touch this stuff, but they needed to in order to, you'll hear the American Paris Ballet in the film is different from the original in that certain strains continue throughout and certain, for example, the pompiers, the firemen who come through, that becomes a repeated phrase so that people know they're marching through and they come through with that same music. So, but otherwise it was generally and very often the arrangers would give Gene what he needed to get into the music so that he wasn't just coming out and bursting into song because it was so unnatural if you just kind of come out on stage and go, ah! People think, why is he out in the rain singing? You know, what is that? And so it was the arrangers who gave him the little intros and things that would lead him in that made people accept the disbelief of what was happening.
Well, in an interview with the Scottish newspaper, you mentioned that Gene incorporated Scottish dance steps into the most iconic dance of course, Singing in the Rain. How did that come about?
Well, again, he would use, he always said that, he always said that the Sing in the Rain number was just a simple Irish clog dance that anyone can do. And I think most people think they can do it and they do go out and do it. And little kids, little three-year-olds do it and do a pretty good job with it. But it's looks so simple and yet it is kind of a sophisticated mix. And you do see some of the Bill Robinson, but you also see the crossing over on the sidewalk and is going over the edge and the crossing steps and things. So it's quite you see a lot of very varying tap steps, and then you do see the Scottish kind of crossing dance and things. So he sneaks in all kinds of things. And as I say, I'll read you some of the words on the page on his score for the ballet. It's phenomenal what he goes through from one thing to the next. So he had this facility that he could move from one form to another effortlessly. It's not clunky. You don't see anything in there that goes like clunk. Oh, just went from an over the top step to a Scottish sword number. No, it's like you just kind of, you don't even notice the steps in a weird way. I mean, I think a lot of people don't even think about it. They're so caught up in the joy of the movement.
Okay, so you have mentioned towards the end of his life, Gene was working on a project about Robert Burns, the Bard of Scotland. So can you tell us how he envisioned it, how far along it was before he passed away?
Well, it was a project that obviously came to him, and it was this fellow David Guest who produced it, and he had brought in Anthony Perkins, and the writer was a lovely guy, and I'm just missing on his name right now, but the guy was going, I want to say Rosie was his last name, and I think it was a great idea, but it just, and Gene, I remember getting all of the Robert Burns books for Gene because whenever he took on anything, he didn't do anything in small ways. You know, if he wanted to read, he'd say to me, I'd like to reread all of Charles Dickens. And then I'd have to go and get all of Charles Dickens. And then he'd say, I'd like to reread all of Evelyn Waugh. I'd go get all of it. So I have all of the Robert Burns here in the collection because he just devoured it. And I think was very excited about the possibilities, but it was very hard. Just try to bring in Michael Jackson, David Guest, Anthony Perkins. It was kind of one of those things that I think just, it's very hard to get off the ground. Again, to get something like that off the ground outside of the studio system. And it just all kind of fell apart. It just never came to be, but he would have loved it. He loved Burns. And again, the romanticism of it. So, mm-hmm. but I it never happened. I have the notes for it here, but I don't know. I kind of doubt anybody will pick that up. I don't think, I don't think David Guest is in a position to do that. And
I know Hugh Jackman, it took him 10 years to get Greatest Showman off the ground. So
everything is very, very, it's so hard. And that was what was so, Gene wanted to do Frankie and Johnny with Michael Jackson. And we went to Michael Jackson's house to talk about it. And Gene, it was an incredible night where Michael stood up and recreated all of Gene's numbers from Gene's television specials and did them absolutely spot on, even the hat and everything. And then Gene stood up and did, it was like a challenge dance. And Gene got up and did the numbers, the cakewalks and things that he thought should be in Frankie and Johnny. And I was sitting in the middle of them just kind of going, those are the moments you wish you could record in your mind everything. I tried to. But then it just became, there are too many handlers, there are too many this and too many that and too much. I think ageism kind of comes into play, because I think that there's a sense that there was a sense that Gene was old. He's in his 80s, 70s, 80s. He can't possibly have a contemporary idea. They forgot that during his entire life, he was always ahead of his time. You know, he was always looking forward and innovating and creating things that had never been done. So he wasn't, he never wanted to recreate what he did. He wanted to do something new. And so I think they really missed, I mean, because that was to have music with Quincy Jones. And I mean, it would have been fantastic.
Yeah.
But there were too many managers and handlers and people who thought, no, you know, let's go on, make the next blockbuster bad or something, which they did. And
aside from your work on Gene's biography, you have been doing a one-woman show, Gene Kelly, The Legacy, where you show his film clips. You have The Variation, which is Gene Kelly, A Life in Music, with film clips accompanied by the live orchestra, as you've mentioned. You discuss his life and career. So how did that come about, and how did your collaboration with Royal Scottish National Orchestra begin?
It all started with Gene, what would have been Gene's 100th birthday in 2012. And Gene was so specific with me about how he wished to be remembered. And as I've said, it was for being behind the camera and for changing the look of dance on film and for creating a particularly American style of dance and an American costume. I mean, you look at how he changed the look of the dance. So you didn't see that before. You didn't see a guy in khaki pants and a sweater and a cap and a scarf. And so he had really given me that. He said, you know, that was what I was to do, was to get that out there if it was possible. And so when usually the Academy of Motion Pictures, for what would have been a legend's 100th birthday, they usually had a kind of tribute to the legend, and they were extremely well done. I remember I went to one for Jimmy Stewart, but very often it would be kind of the people that were left. It would be people who might have worked with the person, or and sometimes you got some of the mythology kind of woven into some of that. And I thought, well, here's an opportunity to present Gene as he wished to be presented. And because he had specifically asked not to have a memorial service of any kind. So I respected those wishes. But I went to the Academy and I presented this idea. I said, I'd like to create the evening. I'd like to present Gene as he wished to be presented as a creative person. And they agreed and really gave me carte blanche. And I really credit them, because people say, well, how long did it take you to write your show? And I say, well, I wrote it overnight. And, but I wrote it overnight over 2 decades, you know, right. It's the kind of thing that, I mean, it was in my head for so long. But this was an opportunity to just get it out there. And I literally did just write it out, and I went in and presented it to them, and they said, okay. And so we premiered it at the beautiful Samuel Goldwyn Theater of the Academy in 2012. And it was, I think it sold out in probably 15 minutes or something. It was really amazing. And there were some elements in it that I don't take on the road with me. For example, Justin Timberlake was, he introduced it. And actually, Hugh Jackman gave me a cold open from the set of Les Miserables. And then Justin Timberlake came out. And so there are a few of those elements that I don't take with me on the road. I'm sure I would sell out in 5 minutes if I did. But, it was like a coming out party for me. It was because prior to that, people wrote me these notes, and I know they meant well when they wrote them, but they would say, you know, we didn't know you could do anything. We didn't know that you could speak or you could write or you could stand up and talk. You know, I mean, they wrote it in a nice way, but it was like they never saw me. I was just the person standing next to Jean. I wasn't out talking. I wasn't doing anything. I wasn't even overtly writing his memoirs. I was just behind the scenes always. And often, I mean, people will say to me, they'll say, oh my gosh, we had dinner with Jean at Spago restaurant. It was amazing. And I'll say, yes, there were four of us. I was there. You know, it's a lot of people came up to me after that, and I got a lot of mail after it, saying that they had no idea that Jean did all this stuff. They had no idea he created it. They had no idea he directed. They forgot he directed Hello, Dolly. They forgot he created the first time that he danced with himself and that he danced with Jerry the Mouse. I mean, some knew it, but they didn't know that he mechanically understood and what you were saying about the connection with the music and everything. So it was just kind of a journey into his heart and mind that they had never experienced. They loved him, but they didn't know him. And at the end of it, it goes into the end of his life and his death and the aftermath and how you begin to deal with grief and loss. And I, you know, literally unpack his belongings on stage. And you hear his voice singing just this pristine recordings of him. And so it was a way to introduce him to people who didn't know him and reintroduce him to people who thought that they knew him and loved him. And so it just kind of took off like Topsy. That first night, I think it ran about 4 hours with no intermission. It just kind of went on. We had a few other people in there. Natasha Kinski came in to talk about how he taught her tightrope walking for One from the Heart. And it was just kind of magical, but it was exceptional. It was very long, but nobody seemed to mind. And then, so then afterward, I took out the extraneous wonderful elements, like Justin Timberlake talking for 20 minutes and it became a 2 hour and 20 minute show, what without intermission, that I've taken on the road since 2012. And I am going to Scotland with it on September 5th. It'll be at Inverness with Eden Court. And so got me up there into Glasgow. And of course I'm very good friends with Christopher Hampson, who's head of Scottish Ballet, and you've had the opportunity to chat with him. And I think you adore him as much as I do. He's just brilliant. And talk about a visionary. And Christopher and I just both happened to be in Paris before the lockdown. And we were both going to see Crystal Pite at the Paris Opera Ballet. And we were going up the stairs and I said, oh, by the way, Jean did a ballet here and to Gershwin's Concerto in F in 1960, and you should do it. And so he responded right away, but he said, you know, I think it's a great idea, but we really couldn't look to that till maybe 2024 or something. And then he called me in January and just said, I'd like to start now. I think this is a perfect time. And we can start working on this during the lockdown, and we can start getting the designs and the costumes and everything ready. And you and I can start working on the choreography, which I just happen to have Jean's handwritten notes for here on the floor. And so Chris and I got on these long Zoom calls where I had scanned, had scanned the entire score that I have that was saved from Gene Spire. It's singed, but it was saved.
Oh, wow.
And so he's looking at it on his computer. I have it on mine, and we're going through it because Gene's handwriting is not legible generally. he was good at a lot of things, but that reading his writing, and it was a cryptic. He never had a formal dance notation like Laban or anything. It was his own little shorthand that he had learned in Pittsburgh, writing down all the acts very quickly. He had a shorthand of crossover and how to write that as a times two and things that only he said, only no one else can read this. Only I can read this. Well, so Chris and I started going through this in the pages. And so, and Chris is like, what is this? And it's going. And so what we began to realize is, okay, here we have on one page, fouette, pirouette, jazz walk, corkscrew, step kick. Another page, bandy twist, knee pops, kick turn, Susie Q, drag tango, glissade, jeté, Jean, which means do a jeté like Jean did them, dehors piqué, glissade tour jeté, step, step, arabesque, balancé, pas de basque, chassé, glissé, Jesus, Jewish wedding, strut, strut, Charleston, Lindy. And so as we're going through this, we began to decipher it and pulled everything. And it was this phenomenal. It was like taking me back to the Melville work, because this is what I did with Melville, is I would follow Melville's creative process. And I'd go, oh my gosh, he crossed out that word and put that word in. Uh-huh. And aging, crossing something out, or a question, maybe this will be a phrase. And so Chris digested all of that with me. And then he has incorporated that in the kind of new capsule that is going to hold the original ballet. So now it's the original ballet, but it has this kind of prelude that Chris extracted from Gene's notes by taking some of the things Gene was working on and trying and experimenting and things that he then took further and things like that. So it's,
wow,
it's bringing all of the, it's all Gene that you'll experience, but it's Gene's creative process. And then it's the ballet itself in this newly encapsulated thing with Les Brotherston doing the sets and costumes, but with a kind of nod to the original creator, this man named André François, who was again revolutionary because he was, had never been used to create the, he was an illustrator for Punch and he'd never been used as a designer for the Paris Opera. And so Gene's the first American born choreographer to premiere a work at the Palais Garnier. It's the first time jazz music is heard with the Gershwin Concerto in F. And it's the first time André François's extraordinary sets are whimsical things. There are boats up in the air, there are thunderbolts, there it's all this stuff going on. So
what's Chris doing with it that might make it a little bit different? What's he doing to transition it to Starstruck now?
Well, I think the thing is that, again, it fits very much with Gene's thing of don't take what I did and imitate it, go beyond. And so, as Chris said, we didn't want to leave it sitting in aspic. You wanted to take it and what was revolutionary in 1960, I mean, walking into a theater and suddenly hearing Gershwin just blew people out of their seats. Well, now that isn't so unusual. So Chris has kind of crafted this way to bring people in, to kind of almost seduce them into it before you get to that big Gershwin. And so the Gershwin then will have the impact that it had, but it'll be in a different, presented in a little different way. And then Les has created a way of kind of referencing the 1960, the glamour of the, you know, a black tie event at Palais Garnier. And all of the glitterati of Paris, all of the top stars there and the beautiful people and the beautiful, and then everyone moving into the other room. Eugene is presented with the Legion d'honneur at the end. So he's created given the presentation that meant so much to him to be acknowledged by the French for that. So I think Les is going to give people a little sense of how the impact and the 22 plus curtain calls and how this just shook the chandeliers of Palais Garnier's. I think they're very astute. I mean, it's a great team. It's a brilliant team. A very respectful team. It's a team I trust. I mean, I've wanted to do this for 20 years. This has been 20 years in the making for me. I first went to Paris to look at the bibliothèque, to look at the maquettes and study and talk to the Claude Bessy, who was the original Aphrodite, and talk to André François on the phone. And so Scottish Ballet is the right place for it. I needed to trust somebody. I needed to be able, in order to allow someone to go beyond, I needed to trust that company. And I needed to trust Chris and Les and the entire team. But those two in particular, I've got to wear my hat that kind of protects Jean's integrity, but I have to allow it to move and let these two creative artists move and do what they would do if Jean were present. If Jean were here working with them, let them explore that. I wish he were here. That would be the best thing for this, because I know what I know, but he lived this. He lived these words. He lived this movement. This was part of him. It was is in his soul. I'm not a dancer for sure. And so, but I think it was trusting them, and then also their narrative ability and their acting ability, that they realize how much of this has to be conveyed in the face. And one of the ballerinas was saying, I hope we can take our masks off, because she misses being able to convey. And you don't see a lot of that done very well by a lot of companies, but they're very good at that. And then about the movement telling the story. So I'm ecstatic, and I'm ecstatic that we'll be able to open up to do it, and that I can get there without going into 10-day quarantine, and that they're going to film it. So it will be part it's going to be filmed.
One last question before we let you go. When can we expect to see your biography of Jean in our local bookstore?
Boy, I think memoir is probably better, because it will not be a strictly chronological biography, and certainly won't encompass everything, because that's been done. It hasn't been done well, but it isn't. I'm not trying to do that. I'm trying to do kind of an extension of what almost a supplement, complement to the show, to take you a little further into who this man was. The writing is not difficult at all. It comes very fast, but I had some distractions, and now I need to spend more time in the archives to get things a little more organized, and then I can just kind of lay it out. I thought I would be further along now, but I hope to get back to it when I get back from Scotland. But then I may be back on the road again. So it's time. I mean, it's time. I need to get it done, and I will try to find the openings, because I'm not a good person. Some people can write when they're on the road and doing stuff, but I need to kind of be here. Too much of the material is here. And I write as I go, but I really want to start this and write sequentially through it and tell the story. It's time to do that. And I'm kind of, you've probably seen in the online, I'm kind of testing the waters with things. I mean, I've become much more personal. Originally, years ago, I would just post a picture and a date and say what it was. And then I started kind of sneaking out to test and see was it okay if I even used my voice? I thought people might say, we don't want to hear from you. And it's been quite the opposite. So I and to allow the kind of vulnerability and the kind of tenderness and things, it's been really helpful. It's been a real guide to what people want to know. And same thing like with the Brigadoon. I mean, you trust the people, and it's a lovely group. I really feel, I feel like it's a very valuable thing for me. So I don't know, but also you'll probably hear me screaming from Los Angeles, or you'll hear my mother screaming from Colorado when it's done. It's like, you know, because you can't just keep talking about the book. But I have to keep, like, the ballet, I didn't expect. So I thought from January on, I was full on working on the book. Well, no, this little thing called the ballet came up. So I just think you go with whatever that flow is. And so now it's the one woman show, the symphonic show, the ballet, I hope is the book. And then there's a second and a third book that will come. And then it's the virtual collection that will go around the world. And that's just the plan. So I just have to live a lot longer.
Thank you so much for listening to the St. Andrews Society of Los Angeles podcast. For more information on the St. Andrews Society of Los Angeles, visit www.standrewsla.org. And don't forget to like our Facebook page, Instagram, and YouTube channels as well. Have a great week, and we'll see you next episode.